So if I may, I would say that hotspots policing is one example of something much bigger, a broader umbrella of evidence-based policing, which includes the three T's: targeting, selectively choosing the highest priority targets, the most harmful offenders, the most harmed victims, the most harmful locations, which are the hotspots. And that's all targeting. And then the testing of what works with each type of target, the offenders, the victims, the places. And thirdly, the tracking of, well, if we say the police are patrolling in the hotspots, are they really patrolling there? Are they doing 100% of their patrols? Are they doing 50%? Is it more this week than last, less this year than the year before? So these broader strategic principles of using evidence in policing at a high level of choices, choosing between crimes of different categories to decide what is the best use of limited resources. It's a very comprehensive and systematic approach to considering all of the things that Herman Goldstein wrote about in his 1977 book, Policing a Free Society. And he said, look, the police have to do this and they have to do that and they have to do all these other things. And we don't really have a way to choose among them except through informed police discretion. And that made a big impression on me when I read the book in 1977. And when I developed evidence-based policing, I said, we need a way to make those strategic choices. And that principle led to the Crime Harm Index, which is an integral part of evidence-based policing, but it's not an integral part of problem-oriented policing. Because I would argue that problem-oriented policing is a tactical strategy for dealing with one problem at a time. But it is not a strategic framework for looking at the whole of police service in relation to the whole of harm from crime and, shall we say, negligence of traffic and other factors. Why are people dying in a community? How do we minimize the death? Why are people suffering from sexual assaults? How do we minimize that? How do we balance that with the domestic abuse of minor injuries, but a huge volume? How do we deal with child sexual exploitation? All of these things cry out for all of the attention of the police. And if they do that, they ignore all this other stuff. So I don't think problem-oriented policing solves that problem. What problem-oriented policing says, if you have this problem, which you have scanned and identified, then you should analyze and respond and then assess. So that's SARA. And that's what evidence-based policing says we should do in effect with every target. But what evidence-based policing also does is to look at all of the problems through the Crime Harm Index and rank orders the problems and gives you a framework, not for making all decisions, but certainly for asking big questions like what percent of police time should be spent looking proactively for unreported crimes and what percent should be answering the telephone and sending a police car. And even if you ask this question of the telephone and the police car, the next question is, why are you sending the police car when you could have the phone conversation right away? Or you can have a Zoom call with the crime victim who's calling the police. And we've just finished an experiment with 500 domestic abuse cases in which the caller was randomly assigned to have a Zoom conversation and to see the police officer in white shirt and tie and have the same conversation right away within 1 minute of calling that they would have if they waited 4 hours or 4 days sometimes to have the police come by and talk to them in person. And so evidence-based policing is always looking for more effective ways, more cost-effective ways to deliver the same outcome. Problem-oriented policing is not focused on cost-effectiveness. It's focused on, here is one situation we want to fix. Can we fix it? Or if Herman Goldstein, who I was able to help the Swedish Minister of Justice to present the Stockholm Prize in Criminology shortly before his death, Herman Goldstein would say, we need problem-oriented policing to understand all of these problems, and that will better inform our decisions about what the overall police practice would be. And he's absolutely right. But I think what he also said in his final speech was that he underestimated the amount of extraordinarily comprehensive data analysis that would be required for problem-oriented policing. After all, when he developed the concept in 1977, 78, and wrote it up in 79, we didn't have microcomputers. We didn't have laptops. We didn't have PCs. We had no idea that we could do the kind of analysis that we do today. So in a way, I would say that there would be no EBP if there was no POP. But the POP was pre-digital policing. And evidence-based policing is absolutely post-digital. It's part of the modern digital age with artificial intelligence to do algorithmic forecasting of high and low risk, and lots of other tools that come out of the digital analysis of large sets of data and using the best knowledge humans have about forecasting the weather, forecasting epidemiological spread of disease. And all of those tools can be incorporated into policing because we now have digital data. And so lots of police would say, good, let's have more data. Let's use computers, but don't tell me what we conclude from them because I know in my head. I can put it all in my head. I don't need a computer. Well, I'm sorry. I can't keep it in my head. I don't think anybody else can. You're not in one place in a city 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. So how can any one police officer do what they do in Northern Ireland? The commanders look at the map and they say, these are the dangerous places and go patrol there. And one of our Cambridge students did a master's thesis on how much crime was where the commanders targeted it and how much crime was happening where they weren't targeted. And they found that the commanders were way off. And then a second student did the same thing with patrol officers. Where do you think the most crime is happening on your beat? And they got about 15, 20% of them right. And they missed the other 80% of the places they named weren't having much crime. And they missed lots of areas that were having lots of crime. So clearly they don't know where the hotspots are, which the commissioner of Scotland Yard has said, please know where the hotspots are. We don't need all this statistical stuff. Mm-hmm. Well, yes, you do. Because if you want to do the best you can, you need to have up-to-date targeting information as well as up-to-date testing information. So if we go to hotspots policing, we now have over 60 experiments consistently showing one. Hotspots patrols as little as 15 minutes a day reduce violence and harm substantially if they're high violence hotspots. You can reduce the harm by police presence. Number two, it doesn't just move crime around the corner. It doesn't show any increase in crime in the immediate adjoining areas. And many police leaders would say, hotspots doesn't make sense because you just push the crime around. Well, the offenders actually can't go anywhere because some gang in the other area might kill them for coming in on their territory. So we have good evidence that hotspots policing works, and many police leaders might say they use it. But the truth is that the police minister of England and Wales came to Cambridge 2 weeks ago, and he said, hotspots policing is the most evidence-based practice we have, but it's not being used across Britain. It's not being used, and we need to use it. And we're giving you tens of millions of extra pounds to do hotspots policing, but you can only use it for hotspots policing. So it's the first time a national government has actually said, you get extra money, but only if you put the police where the serious violent crime is happening. And it's starting to change British police practice, that we have both the evidence and the political judgment that the way policing should be done is based on the evidence. And that's very different from last year. So it's very exciting times for evidence-based policing, that in the cradle of the British model of democratic policing, we are finally moving forward like public health, as opposed to a kind of rebranded approach to some things police always did well, like public order without guns, which is absolutely revolutionary in the 1830s when the police invented mass crowd control without weapons, except the stick. And they invented the baton, the stick charge, four officers in a row, like a Roman phalanx, charging into thousands of people very fast. And the people all ran away and nobody got hurt. Nobody died. Police got kicked a bit. And in fact, a fair number of police died in some of those things, but the people didn't die. So the police have done lots of great things without statistics. There's no question that as making a more peaceful, less violent society, the police have been probably the leading invention in human history. But we can do better, and we should. And every time murder starts going back up, as it is in the US and in the UK, we can turn it around. We just have to sit down and look carefully at the data and the testing data as well as the targeting data, and then tracking to see if we're putting the police where the serious violence is. And the evidence is consistent. If we do that, we will have a safer society.